Sir David Attenborough. Right, now, David, no. You're obviously a broadcasting legend, so I'm not going to sit here and diss you, but is there any truth to the rumour that you bagged your first job in TV without having really seen any?
Yes.
You're not really qualified.
I've seen one programme.
What was it?
It was a play by Ennui, transmitted live. I forgot what it was called. I hadn't got a television set. My wife-to-be, my girlfriend had, parents had. I saw that, and I applied for a job in radio, and I didn't get an interview, and a fortnight later, someone wrote to me from the BBC and said, we've got this new thing called television. people are being quite rude about it, but we think there could be something in it. Would you like to come to Alexander Palace and see if you'd be interested? Really?
So we're talking about 1952,
yeah.
And it was then known as the Talks Department.
Well,
I mean, it sounds like sort of radio with pictures, really.
Well, that's indeed so. But what other name would you give to which was... It was effectively all non-fiction television. And there were about a dozen, no, less than that, eight television producers who did all non-fiction. I just exclude sport and outside broadcast, but all the rest. I mean, religion, politics, quizzes, cooking, knitting, all that sort of stuff. And I used to do sometimes, it was all live, I should say. And I would produce maybe one or two programs a week. That was quite intense. It wasn't always like that, but we did anything. And people would come into the canteen and said, we've got a problem. And the Radio Times is just going to press and we've got absolutely nothing for next Tuesday at 7:30. Anybody got any ideas? Oh, you know. Really.
Well, what I love, people probably don't realise why we call it the gallery in television, but in Alexandra Palace it was literally, wasn't it? Where it comes from.
It was a gantry
high. So it's a classic showbiz story in lots of ways, because you were the understudy who became the star in a sort of way. I mean, you stepped in front of the camera when the original presenter of Zoo Quest was a gentleman called Jack Lester. He was taken unwell.
Yes.
And you were producing, is that right?
Yes. It was the London Zoo sent out an expedition to collect animals. I mean, we cooked it up with this chap, lovely man called Jack Lester, who was an expert on reptiles. And I said, look, I want to go to Africa, you know. And he said, yeah, well, come on. And we cooked up this idea. And the idea was that we would film Jack collecting things. And then when we got back, we would show them live in the studio. And the first program, this was 1954, the first program, poor Jack was very ill. And so the second program was going on the next week. It was live, and Jack had dropped out. And the director of television said, Attenborough, you will have to go and do it. Go on over. Staff, no fee, I remember he said.
Very clearly. Just part of your remit.
It's part of your job.
Yeah.
And so I did. And then I did the rest of the series. And then the following year, we were going to do it again, because it was quite a success. But again, Jack was going to do it. And again, he went out. But this time, he came very ill indeed, just before the transmission, halfway doing the expedition. And so I took over. And it was too good a racket to let it go. And Jack was very keen on saying, you know, OK, you carry on, which is what I did for the next 10 years. Really.
So that first time when the cameras go live and the red light goes on, that very first time, do you remember that? Were you terrified or did you take to it?
Well, I've been doing live programmes as a director. So the atmosphere of the studio, which, of course, as you know, and many of you here will know, I mean, it's champagne, isn't it? I mean, it's really very, very exciting. And particularly when you know it's live. And particularly, I mean, when you drove away from the evening, you know, you're coming down from Alexander Palace around the North Circular, and if there was that eerie glow on those curtains, you know, there were no people there with a television set. and they would have been watching you, they would have seen your programme, and you almost wanted to stop and knock on the door and say, do you think it was all right? I'm awfully sorry about that last bit. Yeah. But it was champagne stuff, yeah.
But you think how the world has changed now, because, I mean, that programme, Zoo Quest, there you were going to collect animals for the zoo. I mean, it seems unfathomable to us now as a natural history programme, doesn't it?
Oh, yes. And zoos don't do that anymore. It was the fag end of a Victorian tradition, really. And quite right, too. I mean, the natural world's under enough problems as it is without people going out trying to catch more things. But, in those days, we didn't have long enough lenses to get close-ups of animals at any distance. Okay. So the only way you're going to see the close-up of, say, a Gaboon viper, you know, is about to strike one of a cobra about to strike, you couldn't film that, really, properly. So the thing you do was you have to do it in the studio, which is what... So the excuse was, there was a chap from the zoo who knew and understood about catching cobras and Gaboon vipers and so on. He would pick it up, and that was on film, and then in order to get the details and show how this, that, and the other, you had it live in the studio, because where you could really get close, you could really get cameras close, and so on, so that's what we did. If you saw them now, you couldn't believe how crude they were. But at that time, you see, nobody had seen an aardvark. No, nobody had seen a sloth. And so everything you did, it didn't matter how badly you did it, they hadn't seen that sort of stuff before. And so they thought, did you see the aardvark last night?
I know the thing that you kept looking for. In fact, one of the reasons why you did Zoo Quest, you were looking for a white-necked rock fowl.
Yes, indeed.
Did you ever find it?
Yes, we did. Yes, we did, actually. I mean, and we... I remember we actually... We called it by its proper name, which was Picathartes gymnocephalus.
Oh, I say.
And, yeah, there you are. And I remember... this quite unimportant bird, the only qualification it had was that nobody had ever seen it alive, no European had ever seen it alive. So we actually caught quite early on in the expedition. We was 3 months out there, but we didn't let on for that. See,
no.
The first programme, here we are, we're going out to look for Picathartes gymnocephalus, you see. And then at the end, you wouldn't see the damn thing, but at the end, you'd say, well, so we continued our quest for the Picathartes. And the cameraman and I, Charlie Lagos, who was the film cameraman, we were in his little red open MG driving along Oxford Street, I remember, which you could do then. And we were a bit worried about this Picathartes gymnocephalus. I mean, was the great British public going to become frightfully excited by that? So? And as we stopped by the lights, the bus driver leant down and he said, hello, Dave. He said, but are we or are we not going to find Bicker Bloody Party?
Would have been lousy telly if you'd said at the beginning that you'd already got it, wouldn't it? Yeah, no, it was terrible television. What was it about presenting that made you want to continue? What was
the racket of going out there.
Right.
I mean, yeah, I mean, that was the fun. My job was a television producer, and the Zoo Quest stuff was the thing you did half the year. The other half of the year, I produced prime ministers' broadcasts, and I produced quizzes and all sorts of things, and travel programmes. But it was the spring of television. I mean, we were just starting. You know, only one network, you know, 405 line pictures. You couldn't tear yourself away from it. It was so exciting, and every time, and people used to just think of programs and dream them up and say, "Look, what about a program on heraldry?" And they say, "Heraldry? Oh, a very good idea. I think we'd have to first class while you're there." And we used to do that. That's what we used to do.
I mean, that's a wonderful time to be there with lots and lots of firsts. And presumably, I mean, your whole career has been full of firsts, but the first time you saw, for example, a Komodo dragon, or the first time that you saw a creature that had not been filmed and shown into people's sitting rooms, there must have been a moment of just supreme excitement that you're saying to people, come and see what I've got.
Unbelievable. I mean, it was... you see, people hadn't seen anything. I mean... The Komodo dragon had never been seen on film. That's not quite true. The Americans in the 1920s, who actually were the first person to actually notice that there was this unknown species so far, they had filmed it, but it hadn't been filmed on nobody on television had seen it. And that film that they took in the 20s, nobody had seen that either. So effectively, this was the first time. And it was, you know, I was able to say quite truthfully and honestly, you know, nobody's seen this before. Here is the biggest lizard in the world. And everybody said, yes, astounding. And it, what a privilege, though, you know, to and the thrill of it. Mind you, it was absolutely balmy. I mean, the way we did it, I mean, it took us 3 months. The cameraman and I just pushed off. I remember the boss of the chap who looked after the business affairs, the talks department, who was, for some reason or other, if you know the BBC, it would be very typical of those days. He was an expert in Icelandic sagas.
Oh, and that, perfect.
Yes, he was. Idea. Absolutely ideal for the job.
Yes.
And I remember he said, what sort of budget do you want? I said, well, not a lot because, you know, feeding on rice and, you know, I said, I don't know, say £500 a programme. He said, yeah, I think it's perfectly reasonable. How many programmes? And I said, well, I think about six probably. Yes, very good idea. Back for Christmas, will you be? And I said, goodbye.
No health and safety briefing?
None at all. I couldn't speak a word of Indonesian. I mean, it was absolutely balmy.
Did you have to write home and say, we're all fine, it's all carrying on?
Yes, if you wanted a reply. That was 3 weeks to get a letter home. There was no radio, there was no telephone.
Yeah.
I mean, I said goodbye to my dear wife and I'll see you on Christmas.
I think programmes should be made like that now. I think that's absolutely fantastic.